Hello and welcome to This Woman's Work, a space where you can hear and read about some amazing women, the fantastic jobs they do, and the paths that have led them to where they are today. I'm here for break room, actually number four. This is break room four. So if anyone doesn't know, break rooms are a little bit different to the normal career chats because they try and focus on specific subjects with a fab woman. And today I'm joined by Jo. Hi, Jo.
Hi.
And Jo has been forced to sit down with me because today's podcast is all, or today's break room, I should say, is all about career change. So it's a chat about making those decisions to change your career, impacts, all of that kind of stuff. But what's particularly interesting about Jo's podcast is because we are in my themed teacher week and that plays into your career change. So without further ado, we're going to get cracking. That's all right.
Yeah, brilliant.
Okay, so just to quickly touch on, what is it you do now for a living?
I work in the pharmaceutical industry. So my title is I'm a regional healthcare manager, which means nothing to anybody that's not in pharma. But basically, my job is a little bit removed from the branded medicine, but I'm looking to try and find projects where you can partner with the NHS to drive improvement in outcomes for patients living with certain conditions that align to our brands that we sell.
Okay. And that's what you've kind of, if we track back, that's what you did. So very quickly, did you go to uni?
Yeah, went to uni, did a degree in podiatry. So I trained as a podiatrist.
Ooh.
So talking about career changes, that was my first. I qualified and practiced.
In that case, we've got to go even further back then. So what led you to wanting to do a degree in...
So I really like biology and sciencey type stuff.
Yeah.
And when I went to do my A-levels, I was told I couldn't do biology because I didn't have chemistry or physics GCSE because I'd gone to a really small boarding school where you couldn't do those subjects. And so I didn't do any sciences in my A-levels. And so I was looking for something that was a bit kind of patient focused and something that I could do without having to have a science necessarily, and podiatry was one of them. So I did some, there was a guy on Oakham High Street that used to have a podiatry practice near Mermaid Fish and Chip Shop, and I went there for work experience when I was 18 and worked with him.
Wow.
And I really loved it. I thought it was brilliant. So I applied to uni and got a place and then failed my A-level spectacularly, which I think a lot of people do.
Oh, it's a common thing.
Yeah. And then I ended up going through clearing and getting a place up in Salford in Manchester. And off I trundled, having never been there.
Still a really cool place to go, though.
Yeah, had a great time.
Yeah.
And so I got my degree and then... was all up for being a podiatrist because I really wanted to do, I did a placement up there at the Northern General in Manchester that was all around diabetic medicine. So you go there and people have got toes amputated and stuff and diabetic neuropathy. I thought it was so exciting. I just really wanted to do that.
Amputation interest.
I just liked all that kind of gory stuff anyway. And then I got put on a placement to go round the old people's homes of Preston.
Right.
With a guy for about 3 weeks, and I was 21, and I just thought, I don't think I want to do this first. And all the jobs that were available were all kind of cut and come again, chiropody, and you're a bit on your own. And I thought, I'm 21.
And that is old people spec, isn't it?
Yeah. It wasn't being in the hospital with the diabetes multidisciplinary team, which is what I really wanted.
Yeah.
But of course, when you're so impatient and young and hungry, you just think, you know, there'll be something else I can do. And my sister had been at uni with somebody who was a drug rep. And I'd never even heard of that job. And well, that sounds good. I'll do that.
And it's linked, isn't it? It is linked.
But you have to have a life sciences degree to do it.
Oh, do you?
Yeah, that's what their preference is that they have. Because if you're going to go and have kind of high level conversations with physicians, you kind of got to know a bit of medicine.
Yeah.
And my degree had 2 years of medicine in it and anatomy, physiology, all that, microbiology, all that kind of stuff. So I was able then to do the product training to be able to learn to have a big enough conversation with somebody that was far brighter than I about medicines.
Brilliant. Okay. So how did you even get into that then? What, you just sort of looked for jobs and applied?
Well, like I said, my sister knew somebody from uni who was already in a company. And then I was working in a shop in Woking, because my parents lived in Surrey at the time. And, you know, when you get chatting to somebody in a clothes shop, this girl was a drug rep. I mean, again, random that I met her. And she was working in Norfolk and Suffolk at the time. And I went and stayed with her, having not known her at all, and stayed with her and went out with her as a rep.
So then, bossing it in pharma in the late 90s.
Yeah.
You meet the love of your life, obviously. You get married. You have a couple of amazing children.
Yeah.
Still in pharma. You're still taking pharma. All your mat leave, yeah. Blah, blah, blah. Then what triggers this?
So what had happened prior to having the children, I was, I guess, you know, like I said, I was quite hungry for stuff. I was quite driven. Yeah. And I'd done a management secondment down in London. And so when we'd first got married, I went and lived with my sister in London Monday to Friday and came back at the weekends.
Well, oh, wow.
And I was
so
an
just
area
off.
Yeah, I was an area manager. So then I was managing a team of reps doing the job that I'd done. So then it opened my eyes to get, you know, a bit more experience. And then when I came back, I really didn't want to, there wasn't a manager's job around here. So then I got an opportunity to go into head office and be a training manager. Because lots of, you know, when you do a lot of those kind of career assessment things, loads of mine had come out with training and coaching and teaching. And I was thinking, oh, kids, no thanks. That'd be awful. But coaching, so I was a field trainer, a field coach. So then I'd gone in to be a training manager. And then I got pregnant with Millie. And I was commuting down to King's Langley in Hertfordshire, and it was too much.
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
And Laurie broke his leg, and it was this whole hideous time. So it was just better that I came home.
Yeah.
And so, and then your perspective changes a bit, doesn't it, when you have kids? And so I had a good chunk of time off with her and really, really did not want to go back to work.
And just be on the road and
travelling. Well, and I mean, I had a small area. I didn't have to go too far. It was only kind of like Lincolnshire and Leicestershire. But I just, hardly any of my friends went back to work after they had children. So I'd had this lovely kind of 10 months off and nobody else was going back apart from me. Mm. And that was really tough. And I remember saying to Laurie, don't send me back to work. And he was like, fine, we'll sell the house. We'll go and live back in Ladywell in a 2-bedroom house. And I was like, well, I don't want to do that either. So I went back and I thought, well, if I'm going to be at work, I might as well do it to the best of my ability. I've got to be there. And so I wanted to kind of progress. And I had a manager at the time who said to me, just you sit still. Don't worry about anything because everybody knows you're going to have another baby. So you're going nowhere for the time being. And I remember thinking, I don't think you should say stuff like that to people. But, you know, obviously that was probably 2002, something like that.
Yeah.
And they were like,
and actually, he
was right. I was going to have another child at some point, but I still don't think your career
has... as well.
Yeah, it doesn't, nothing stops for fellas, does it? But it seems to stop for women.
Yeah.
And that kind of frustrated me a lot. And
well, and that it just that perception.
Yeah. That you're fit for nothing apart from having babies. That's how it felt at the time. So I was quite kind of incensed by that. Why is nobody kind of looking after me? And anyway, of course, then I did get pregnant and have another baby. And,
well, why not?
And then I took as much time off as I could because I knew I wasn't going to have any more. That was it. I was done.
Yeah.
So I think by the time I'd added extra leave onto my mat leave, I think I'd been off about 14 or 15 months.
Wow.
And so I went back as Millie had started school.
Yeah.
And then I thought, right, I need to just get my act together and see if I can get a different sort of job.
Yeah.
And I got a job as a hospital specialist. So that just means that you're not going to GP surgeries every day. So and I was working on a specialist brand. So that was for mental health. So it was a drug for schizophrenia and bipolar disorder. So I'd just go to the mental health units across Leicestershire and Nottinghamshire.
Oh, gosh, how interesting.
So that was really, it was tough, but it was really interesting.
Yeah.
And it kind of opened my eyes to, you know, things that I hadn't really been exposed to before.
And weren't really ever being talked about back then, were they?
No. And so, you know, this, how it impacts on this, you know, impacted people's lives. And so that kind of really affected me because I guess I'd not really seen any of that before. And then seeing how families could just be destroyed by this, you know, awful illness. And,
that was tragically underfunded.
Yeah, completely. And, you know, people were kind of being put away in hospitals, and like Laurie at the time, obviously being the police, there was lots of people who are clearly self-medicating when they've got mental health problems, and nobody wants them. So the police have to arrest them because they're being drunk and disorderly, and then they're trying to take them somewhere, but the drug and alcohol team won't take them, and then the mental health team won't take them. And, you know, it was like, it just felt awful. And I felt like, God, I'm not making any difference. Yeah. That was the kind of beginning of the end for me. I've got these two beautiful children who I want a better world for, and I've got a lovely husband who's a police officer who feels like
trying
he's doing good.
Trying to change the world, yeah.
And I was like, what am I doing? What am I doing? All I'm doing is making a rich company richer.
Yeah.
And I kind of lost my way with it. My point? And I couldn't see the patient focus part anymore because I was so far removed from what I knew, and, you know, because I didn't feel directly linked to it, I suppose. It just felt a little bit like I'd lost my way.
Yeah.
And I, like I said, I've been doing all these things all the way through my career of what's the best thing for you. And like I said, it kept coming up with this teaching thing that I'd be really suited to that. So somebody said to me, I think you need to go into a school. It's not like having 30 children in your front room. It's very different.
Yeah,
and I was like,
okay.
Really? Because I've had birthday parties here and sleepovers. And
other people's kids.
You know, and you're like, oh, God, it's so difficult. Yeah. Nobody does as they're told. And anyway, in school, it's so different.
Yes. Yeah.
And like, you clap your hands and they sit on the carpet. And it was, and I was like, oh, I see. It's not the same as in one place as the other.
Yeah. So was this, again, a bit of work experience then?
Yeah. So I took a week off work and just went and I worked at the school that the kids were at.
Oh, wow.
And just went and had a look at what it was like in the different classes. And I thought, oh, I think I'm going to really want to do this.
Yeah.
And so I looked into it and I did a PGCE at Leicester Uni for a year. So I kept saying to Laurie, you know, what's the minimum I can earn for us to keep the house? And I needed to earn 20 grand. And that was like the starting salary of a teacher at the time.
Oh, my gosh.
So we had a year of no money.
From my research, I think it's about 28 now, isn't it?
Yeah, it's still not great,
no,
is it?
That is, given what you're doing.
Yeah. I'd never, ever worked so hard as I did as a teacher.
So did your PGCE?
Did my
PGCE
at Leicester.
Were you working as well?
No, so we'd saved up money for me to have the year off.
Yeah.
So we just literally had no money for a year.
Yeah.
And we were very lucky because my parents had moved up here by then. Laurie's mum really helped out. And we had, so then both children were at school.
Yeah.
And we didn't have any nursery fees to pay anymore. And then they, between them, picked them up after school. So Laurie changed his job so he could always drop them off.
Yeah.
And then the grandparents picked up in the afternoon. We thought it was a bit tight to get grandparents to get up at 8 o'clock in the morning.
Yeah,
they're tired.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to be doing that. So Laurie changed his shift so that he could always take them to school. And then somebody, I had a big spreadsheet and everybody knew when they were picking up. And this is the thing that galls me about working women, is that I have got the most fantastic husband. Laurie, I adore you. You're wonderful. But he's directed. I am steering the ship.
Yeah.
And he is really brilliant because he doesn't then say, oh, I don't think we should do this. He just goes, what do you need me to do? Which is why we're still married. And so he was saying, right, how can I help? What can we do together? And how can we make this work?
But actually, I am
the one saying, this is when swimming lesson is, this is when judo club is, this is what bag needs to be here and where, and running a full-time job
and
running a house. And that's all juggling in your head all the time.
Yeah.
And it's bonkers, I think.
It is bonkers. But makes you realise that women should just be running the world. Doesn't it? Just need to get all the politicians out. Okay, so you've done your PGCE. Graduated, did you just start applying to local schools then?
So I got a job at a school in Stamford. So I was at St Gilbert's.
Yeah.
And it was the best first job I could have had because I was...
Good school.
Really good school. They had mixed classes of year 5 and 6.
Yes.
And they had 3 of those classes. So there were 2 other teachers who were really experienced. One was the deputy head, one had been like teacher of the year award or whatever, and then me, and we were 3 that we planned together, and so I learned so much from them. I really didn't want to teach year 5, 6 because I thought, oh, they know so much.
Yeah,
of course they don't, they're up to 11, but I had some brilliant maths genii in my class, and you know, they were in year five. They were amazing.
Yeah. And, wow.
Robert and Sam, and and I still remember them to this day. And they, you know, any time that I was like, you know, you can't do it quick enough, you'd say. Sam would go, no, Miss Stafford, I think it's this. And he was like, yes, Sam, you're absolutely right. Well done. I was just checking that
you were paying attention
and done it properly. And so it was a brilliant, brilliant job.
Yeah.
But the difficulty with it was, what I hadn't realised is, the school holidays didn't quite align.
Of course. So sometimes
Rutland have a 2-week holiday, Stamford had 1 week.
Yeah.
So I did it for 2 years. Okay. And I was like, I think I need to come and teach in Rutland. I really didn't want to teach.
Otherwise you're not getting that benefit, are you?
Mine were both at Langham, and I really did not want to work in the same school as them, because my gut feeling is that it's going to go one of two ways. You're either going to be really soft on your own kids, which the other kids won't like, and it'll be confusing.
Yeah.
Or you're going to be really tough on them. And I thought I would be the really tough on them, which I just don't think is fair on my kids.
No.
So I just thought it's better if I'm not in the same school as them. And so I got a job I applied for a key stage leader's job, which I wasn't sure I was going to get because I'd only been teaching 2 years.
Yes.
But I applied for it, and as a year 5-6 teacher and the key stage leader, and I got it. So I'd already kind of was then on the leadership team.
Yes.
So I did that for a couple of years, and then the school expanded to be a multi-academy trust, and they took on another school, and I became the head of that school. We're still having an exec head over me to be my safety net. But then I was the head at that school then for 3.5 years.
So you went straight from that lead to a head, not even a deputy head?
Yeah, because it was a tiny school, so there was only 4 class teachers there. So I still taught half the time.
Right.
And in my first year there, I still taught year 5-6. But what I soon realised is that actually I was being pulled out all the time. And it's not fair. In those kind of important years, you just don't want to be pulled out. So I ended up then I did that for the first year. And then in the second and third and into the fourth year, I was like the PPA cover. So whoever, you know, when the teachers all get an opportunity now to go and do their planning. So what was really good for me is I'd never done the younger years. So it meant that my half-time teaching was done covering all the other classes. So I could get a really good overview of what was happening across the school and get to know all the children in the school, which was much better for me as the head, because when parents came to talk to me, I got experience of their children in every class.
Brilliant, brilliant. I know you have a little life in your head. I know you have a lot of strength left. I know you have a little life in your head. But hang on, how did you just apply for that job? Was it just a promotion?
Well, because it was the same, because I was already on the leadership team. In Brookhill.
So when you say you were a key stage lead, what does that actually mean?
So that means you're responsible for kind of the teaching and learning of your year 5-6 phases. So we had 1, 2, 3 classes across.
Oh, that is, God, you see, that is, my children left primary school not even that long ago, but I've forgotten they were. Yeah, like you say, there's key stages, isn't there?
Yeah, so there's key stage. So there's 1. Early years, which is the little tiny ones.
Yeah.
Then there's key stage 1, which is year 1 and 2. And then key stage 2 is year 3 and 4, 5 and 6.
Okay.
So I was key stage 2 lead. So I was predominantly 5-6. Was there a lead in 3-4? Was that me?
And in your school system, there was no deputy head. You just had your key stage.
So there was. They had somebody. Did we have a deputy? I think there was when I first started at Brookhill, there was a deputy who was also a year 5 teacher, I think.
Yeah.
And, but then there was a reorganisation.
Yeah.
And what they did is they, we'd had this opportunity to get another school, and I applied for that job there.
Okay.
And went for that job. So I had to go through like an interview process.
Yeah.
But I'd done this like middle leaders training course. I'd already been on. So while I was doing my key stage leader job, I'd also done it's like 1 down from NPQH, which is like the national professional qualifications for head teachers. So I'd done that while I was working as well.
So and by this point, how long had you been a teacher for?
By the time I became a head, 4 years.
Wow, that's got to be unusual, though.
Yeah, I think so. And I think that was probably why I found it so difficult, is that I talked with some amazing people who had taught for years. So anything that came up, if, you know, if you had to change something quickly, they had all sorts of little tricks up their sleeves and in their back pocket ready to go. And I hadn't got that. I was still tapping every night, trying to find the best lesson. And even though I'd stayed in year 5-6, I was thinking, this is really good, I love that, and I'd save it. Oh, what else can I find? Love that, save it. You know, and I was taking hours and hours and hours. And so I always gave myself one day at the weekend to plan and do marking.
Gosh. Yeah.
And I worked every night. So I'd come in from work. I normally got home kind of 6:30, make dinner, and then I would always be on my laptop again after that.
So that is like...
So it was relentless. And, and that's, it was weird because, like, you know, people always say, oh, you have those lovely school holidays. And I was like, if you add up those one day every weekend that I lost in term time, that accounts for your extra leave.
And so, but what you're saying is maybe the more experienced teachers, I guess if someone is considering all of this kind of stuff, because there's no two ways about it. It isn't a 9-to-5, is it? It is long hours. No, there is evenings and weekends. But with a bit more experience, you get a bit better and a bit slicker at it.
Yeah. And also, I think I've got some kind of weird thing in me that I was, because I'd felt so passionate about it and wanting to do absolutely the best. And but I've got these lovely children of my own and I thought, I want them to have the absolute best.
Yeah.
So I think you owe it. You cannot turn up. You cannot go into teaching unless you really love it, because the responsibility is too big. I do liken it to medicine and that kind of stuff, is that you cannot have an off day, because those children deserve better. And I didn't want to turn up and not be ready and not be prepared and not have the best thing that they can do.
Yeah.
And then, you know, when a lesson doesn't go well, you're like, oh, I feel like I've cheated them somehow. So I felt this enormous pressure to be brilliant all the time and to give them the most fun experience. And, you know, when you're trying to teach Roman numerals, that's really hard.
Yeah.
You know, or you're
but
trying
to
teach...
Do you think all your colleagues at the time felt the same way?
I think some do and some don't.
Yeah.
And some, I think some are naturally gifted at it. And I think there are some people that just clearly are born to be teachers. There are some people that I couldn't work out how on earth they could leave at 4:15. But I also felt that there was probably something that I was doing wrong.
So suddenly you're ahead then. It's really hardcore, taking up way too much of your time.
Yeah.
How old are your kids at this point?
So as I moved over, I think Millie was at Catmus and Ollie was still at Langham.
Okay.
And so the catalyst for me was September 2016. Ollie starts at Catmus, so he moves up to secondary school. Millie's going into year 10, so I suddenly realised that she's only got... So, sorry, she was going into year 11. Suddenly realised she's
doing
a GCSEs. And I was thinking, hold on a minute, then she's got A-level. She's only got 3 more years at home.
Yeah.
And I was thinking, I'm missing so much.
Yeah.
And Ollie's got some difficulties himself, and I knew that leaving the little bubble from primary school where Langham had nurtured him and really looked after him and I knew everything, I felt like I was throwing him to the wolves going to secondary school.
And you're not having any time to give him.
Yeah, and anyway, I think he'd been there a fortnight and I said to Laurie, I'm going to have to change my job. I just need to be around a bit more. I don't know what's happening, how he's getting on. He just needed so much help to help him get organised. And I was just working really stupid hours.
Yeah.
And I just got that
trying to detach yourself from that, to focus on that.
Yeah, and I just felt like I'm having this thing where I'm giving all of my time to kids that aren't my own.
Yeah.
And so whilst I was doing it for all these great reasons, I then was thinking about my own family and thought, I've got to prioritise them.
So it's so tricky being a woman, isn't it?
I know.
The things that just sort of guys just don't have to worry about.
And I don't know why it's me that has to be the one that is making sure that everybody's okay, but it still is. And because I was a teacher,
not
and because
always,
Ollie was having difficulties, I was the one doing all the kind of meetings with the Senkos and all the kind of additional support and all that.
Helping him at night with his homework, whatever.
I mean, it was just relentless. And
I mean, just you weren't were flying in your job.
Yeah, but I think kind of if you think about your own values, you know, my family have always put my needs, as in my mum, dad, my sister and I, we were always a very tight unit.
Yeah.
And my priority has to be my own family above all else.
Yeah.
And so I said to Laurie, I didn't kind of have this great burning desire to go back to pharma, but I thought that would be the easiest thing for me to do.
Yeah.
And I happened to get, I didn't leave the company in a, you know, in a bad state.
Yeah.
But I got this job going back to the same organisation, completely different people.
So it almost finished your year, I'm guessing. You have to
I didn't. Oh. I finished at Christmas.
Okay. Oh, yeah, but you have to do finish at a term or something.
Yeah, the end. So I handed my notice. I was almost tempted to hand my notice in before I got a job, but I got a job really quickly.
Wow.
And it just happened to be with AstraZeneca again.
Yeah.
And so I handed my notice in end of September 2016, and I finished in December, started back with AstraZeneca January 2017.
Well, and what was that? Because you've been out of that. You were out of that for what, 6 years, 7 years?
8 years.
8 years.
Yeah. No, hold on, because I was going into my 8th year of teaching. So 8.5 years.
Wow.
And so the first recruitment company I'd gone to said, oh, you've been out too long, you'll never get back in. And then I spoke to somebody else who said, that's absolutely nonsense, you'll be fine, because all the skills that you've got are completely transferable.
Yeah.
And then I got the job being a hospital specialist in the diabetes team.
Okay.
So I was working Lincoln and Leicester.
And similar to what you had been doing.
So exactly the same job that I'd left 8 years. So I felt a little bit like I'd gone backwards. But you soon get over that, because what you realise in private sectors, I'd nearly doubled my money and got a car and you know, all that kind of stuff.
Well, and surely the medical world is so different. It changes so radically.
Yeah.
So what you were doing, or the, you know, product-wise maybe, is all completely different. And as, well, you'd hope that even, you know, obviously, I guess just science moves on, doesn't it?
So. Yeah, and lots of stuff had changed around things like, there's a thing called the ABPI, which is the Association of British Pharmaceutical Industries, and it's all kind of your ways in which you can interact and work with medical profession.
Yeah.
And so that had really, really tightened up, and things had, so back when I first started a million trillion billion years ago, you could do things like take people out for dinner and that. So we did a lot of that in the early days.
Yeah.
Well, all of that's gone.
Yeah.
You're not allowed to do any of that.
You that know? Was almost and quite similar, like, across industries though, wasn't it?
Everybody said
you can't get gifts anymore. No, you can't do this.
We used to have like pens and post-it notes and umbrellas and warning triangle. I still got a stapler from when I started 20 odd years ago.
I got given an iPod.
Oh,
one
wow.
of my jobs when iPods first came out.
Then you
couldn't do that now.
Yeah. So all of that changed. So actually I liked that, because that felt a lot more
honest.
Like, honest, and a lot more like we're peer to peer. We're not, you know, I'm not just trying to sell it.
Of course, I'm trying to bribe you into
I am trying to get them to use your medicine if it's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
But it felt a little bit more transactional rather than like a I'll scratch your back, you scratch my back kind of environment. Anyway, I did that job for, so I started in the January, and by the December I'd got the new job, and so then I was the regional healthcare manager. And so now, instead of going to see like hospital doctors and talking to them, I then try and see like system leaders, and I work all across the East Midlands now. And so I lead the strategy for what we're going to do, you know, in terms of how are we going to drive improved performance and all the rest of it across.
Your progression is rapid, isn't it, in whatever you're doing?
Well, I haven't moved since. I've now been in this job, weirdly, because of COVID and stuff. It was a bit odd.
I mean, that would require a whole other pod, so I'm not going to go into that now, because that would be a pod in itself.
But, So I got started the new job in January 2018.
COVID wasn't even a thing then.
Yeah, I lost my dad very suddenly in April, so I had a really rough year. So I felt like I hadn't really done anything. Then we had COVID, and actually COVID was good for me, because people that I'd never been able to get access to suddenly were at home as well and said, oh yeah, let's talk.
Oh, wow.
So I do a lot still on Teams, and it's really helped me get people together, because whereas you were trying to find a room in the NHS and trying to get X, Y and Z people together, now I just set up a Teams meeting and people dial in from wherever they are, and it's been brilliant for me.
Of course, because it's so much simpler.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So then I got, like, I won a thing, like I was got the top spot in the sales team and all that. Well, I mean, I don't really buy into all of that crap, but it's nice to get it when you get it, because you get extra money and stuff.
So where, I mean, where could you go from here then? What would be?
Well, weirdly, the thing that I'm really interested in at the moment is our corporate affairs team, but with our head office is in London, yeah. So I'd have to be going to London, and I'm not sure. I kind of feel like, would I be going back to making life more difficult for myself? But
you wouldn't have to go every day, though, would you?
They like you in the office 4 days a week.
Oh, do they?
Yeah. So, but there is we have this thing called development within borders, so that you can apply for a job and just do a small project. So I'm actually going to apply for one. So patient advocacy. So you're like being the voice for the patient. Ooh, so again, it feels like it's that's where my strength is, I feel like, because I want to advocate for people. I want to make sure that people are heard. It's a whole project around health literacy, to making sure that patient materials are understandable and accessible. So having a child with SEN, having been a teacher, having got this real drive for patients, I feel probably it'd be a great fit.
Yeah.
And it's only 3 months. It'll be a short-term project. I'll get some experience, and then I can see whether or not the commute suits me. Because Millie's off travelling. Oliver's going off to university. We're going to be empty nesters come September. So maybe it's time to, you know, have a last hurrah before I retire in 10 years' time.
Right, I've got to let you get back to your life, though. So I won't ask you... Well, actually, I will ask you my three final questions. But I always ask everyone. One... Is there any life advice you would like to give your younger self? So little Joe.
Yeah.
Maybe when she was moving around. I don't know. Any life advice? Or just any advice you think she could have done with knowing?
Oh, God. I think I would have liked her to not care so much about what other people thought.
Yeah. That's generally what a lot of people
say. Yeah. I just feel like I spent a lot of time when I was younger worrying what other people thought about me and, you know... And actually, what you realise as you get older is if you're just true to yourself and you know, honest with yourself, then you've got a lot of peace.
Yeah.
And actually,
and
you,
the
can't
right people you can't control. You can't.
Yeah, exactly. And you can't control what other people do, and so there is no point in even trying.
No.
And don't, you know, it's just not. It's not careless, because of course we care and of course we are bothered, but. She was upset by quite a lot of people, and she really needn't have been. Yeah.
Okay. Life advice or advice you think your older self would give you now? So 70-year-old Jo.
Oh, she'll probably say slow down a bit.
Right.
You know, smell the roses and, you know, eat the cake.
Fair enough.
I think that's what she would say.
Yeah.
But I don't know how you can do that. You know, I'm in that sandwich generation at the moment. I've got, thank goodness, my mum's still here. But she's, you know, needs a bit from me.
Yeah.
Laurie's mum needs a bit from us.
Yeah.
And our kids still need us. So we're working full time.
Yeah.
So.
Wow.
So it's like, slow down a bit, probably.
Fair enough. Okay. And then the final thing is just... a life advice or a mantra that you think's great. Something I always describe it as, if Jo had a t-shirt, what would it say?
Oh, blimey. Well, that's a good one.
Is there a mantra that you really subscribe to?
No regrets.
Brilliant.
I've always said that to the kids. You know, don't ever... feel regret for something. Learn from it, absolutely. Yeah. Maybe don't repeat it, but everything you do in your life is teaching you something.
Yeah.
So, and never, never leave things unsaid. That's the one thing when we lost my dad, is there was never any doubt how much he loved us and we loved him. So we didn't have, you know, like some people are like wrapped in, you know, we never had any of that.
Yeah, yeah.
Because even though it was very sudden, I told him every day I loved him, and he told me every day. And so I just think, you don't regret anything. We lived our lives. He lived his life at 100 miles an hour. We're probably doing the same. You don't want to say no to stuff, and you want to just not have a regret in life.
Yeah.
Because then you've got peace.
Brilliant.
So.
Thank you very much, Jo.
Absolute pleasure. It was lovely.
If you would like to hear more about this chat, see some pics and read about how to get started in this industry and or this role, then please go to our website, www.thiswomanswork.org. The link is on this podcast page and across our socials. Sincere thanks.